As we take a continuing consideration of aging negotiation, just to remind you what we discussed during our previous lecture, we consider what is negotiation, what are the main categories of negotiation, and then we start to consider what are main components of negotiation, that also include protocol and strategy and others. So we start to consider what are good properties of negotiation protocols. In this sense, in such sense that when we have a good negotiation property, it should be fair to participants. And among these different features, we consider, you remember, social welfare, convergence, Pareto optimality, and some other things. So, but also we consider that individual rationality is also important because it should be good for agents to participate in some negotiation compared to situation where there is no. And then we start to consider first type of protocols that were voting protocols. Remember voting protocols that everybody submits its preferences, and there is some central unit who, according to some internal routine, will make ordering of these preferences that create so-called social ordering. If it was individual ordering, then show social ordering. And we also consider that it is not possible to have such a social ordering rule creation very good because there are theorems that said that it's not a solvable problem. So, and at the end, I spent some time to restore your memory because it was 1 week ago and maybe you don't remember what it is. So, then we consider also how to work with truthful voting. How to motivate agents to submit truthful ranking, truthful preference. Because if agent will get better result of non-truthful ranking, it's not only agent but human, then it will be done in such a way. And we consider there is one possibility. In general, it is an unsolvable problem, but there are some special cases, and in particular, Clark text algorithm was one of such cases where we consider that we can put some additional paths for ensure truthful voting. Okay, so in general, problem is that we are interested to consider good protocols, and inside of these protocols, good strategy. We started with voting protocols. Now we consider next type of protocol, and in particular the next protocol that we consider will be monotonic concession protocol. And then some other elements. So monotonic concession protocol is extremely simple. Compared to voting, it assumes that there are several rounds. And there are two participants. There is a space of possible views that is defined. And on first round, agents simultaneously propose the deal from negotiation set. And the agreement is reached if one agent finds that deal proposed by another agent is at least as good or better than its previous. So normally, you exchange deals, and finally, you find that some deal is good for both of the agents. If no agreement reached, then negotiation proceeds another round in, of simultaneous proposal. On next round, and here we introduce some rule, no agent is allowed to make proposals that is less preferred than by other agents than the deal proposed on previous time. Okay? This is what I told you. You have to make worth your deal. You cannot do it in starting from the best deal, going to the worst acceptable deal. But you cannot in the middle come back and increase your deal. Okay? Okay. If neither agent consents, then negotiation terminates with conflict. So this is an illustration that agent like start the best deal for this agent is somewhere here, the best deal for another agent somewhere here, and they try to find something in the middle. who is better, the more close it will be to the best deal of this age. Okay? So, advantages of this monotonic concession protocol that it's symmetrically distributed, it's no special role for particular agent, it ensures conversion, it doesn't ensure deep, but convergent and it will finish because it will not go indefinitely. Some happen by accepting deal or in conflict deal, but it will be not infinite. But the advantage is that agent can run into conflict, and it's also inefficient because it can be quite long negotiation, and it's also assumed rationality of agent, that each agent maximizes of its utility. That is not always true in the real negotiation. Key questions. Protocol itself is very simple. But key question with this protocol that we would like to answer will be as follows. First, what should be agent's first deal, first proposal, sorry. It is number two. On any given round, who should concede next? And if agent concede, then how much this agent should concede? It is 1, 2, 3, I'm sorry. Okay? So, protocol is simple, but we would like to answer this question, that are most interesting. Who should concede and how much it concede, if we have the disagreement. And this leads us to notion of strategy. Strategy, basically, is the way how agent behave in negotiation. So, in some sense, strategy is set of action that agent take any time when it make its next beat. So, we consider what could be strategy and how agent can choose one strategy compared to another in terms of negotiation that make this negotiation useful for this particular agent. And we use also a game theory for that, and in this game theory, strategies are called simply as agent, actions of agent. Basically, what is negotiation strategy? We consider it just a set of actions that agent perform any time when it calculates what is next. But basically, it is function from previous history to the next deal. It takes into account what was previously and try to produce something that is good based on what was done. From very general psychological perspective, there could be a fixed set of possible strategies. One is concede unilaterally. That is not good strategy, but possible strategy. You all the time, somebody press to you, but you all the time concede. Okay? Competitive, stand firm and employ pressure tactics. It's opposite. Okay? Cooperative, search for mutual acceptable solution. Actually, this is what we are looking for. When we try that both parties will adjust their preferences in such ways that make a mutually acceptable solution. Also, it's possible in action and break. 3 years ago, 4 years ago even, this course has first homework related to negotiation it was based on special system called INSPIRE. And this system allows that you become a member of some negotiation team and you make negotiation with somebody else in the world, usually other students. This was a research project and they would like to see how people behave in negotiation. And one of our homework was that your student participate in such negotiation, try to do their best in negotiation. Unfortunately, this project was finished 3 years ago and they stopped this system to run. But why I said this? Because the main problem with this homework was that student come to me and say, my partner doesn't answer, what should I do? And basically it is possibly that this partner doesn't care about you and he or she forgot about this negotiation, but it may be also a way to creating you uncertain about something. with such situation, we try, maybe it's too high bit, I have to low it, and it will, and he will answer or not. So inaction and breaking are also psychological way to participate in negotiation. But we are interested only in this one, when we look for or search for mutual acceptable solution where each agent tries to adjust their preference. In order to consider how to build such strategy, we consider one well-known problem. It's called prisoner's dilemma. Maybe you heard about it. So basically this problem says that two men are collectively charged with a crime and have in separate cells. They have no way of communicating with each other or making an agreement, and they are told that if one confesses and the other doesn't, confessor will be freed and the other jailed for 3 years. If both confess, then each of them will be jailed for 2 years. If neither confess, then each of them will be jailed for 1 year. If we consider that confessing is affecting the non-confessing cooperating, then my question would be, if you were one, of course, hypothetically, one of this prison, what would you do? Confess or negotiate? Sorry, or cooperate? Well, it's not clear. It's not clear at the moment. You have some ideas, but it is not clear. Let's consider how to make it extremely clear what is the best. And in order to do this, we need some theory and formal method, and this theory give us the theory that we will use is a game theory. It's mathematical theories that study about self-interested agent. Essential elements of game theory, games in this theory are that there are players, two or more, some choice of fun action, some strategy can be applied, and there can be one or more outcomes that somebody wins, somebody loses. And important that there is always information exchange. This is suitable for situation where behavior of other agent matters. So there are situations that you don't care what your partner does. Whatever he or she does doesn't influence your decision. This is in a simple situation that we do not consider. We consider a situation where your decision depends on what your partner in negotiation can do. Okay. Also, assumptions of game theory are that all players behave rationally, but this is not always the case with all agents. Each player knows the rule, this is clear. Payoffs are known and fixed. You know what, how good some decision is for you and for your partner. It's not like a secret. Everybody knows. And this all creates our limitation. But okay. Now, let's consider our prisoner's dilemma using payoff matrix that we already introduced previously. That said that, okay, this is one prisoner, this is another prisoner, these are actions to be done, and these are payoffs. Please consider that these payoffs just show how good outcome is for agent, but not how many years to spend in jail. It's UT. Okay? And now I repeat my question again. If you were one of these prisoners, what would be your strategy? Strategy, what will be your what would be your action? Cooperate or defend?
Yeah.
Sorry?
Defend.
Somebody said defend. Defend. Other?
Mm-hmm.
Suggestion? Why defend? Yes. Let's consider very simply. If you defend, then your payoff is no less than payoff of a partner, yes? If you cooperate, it's not the case. Yes? So the fact is your best reply to unknown actions that your partner can take from this possible action set. I agree.
No, if you cooperate, you can either 0 or 3 years.
Yes, but if you cooperate, but your partner defect, then you will get 0 utility. You see? If you cooperate, but your partner defect, your utility will be 0. So, unfortunately, the best strategy in this situation is defect. But is it the best strategy, the best outcome that we can get? My question will be, again, more general. Which of these actions are, which of these pairs of outcome are Pareto optimal? Is this one? Is it Pareto optimal?
No.
Why?
Can increase your utility without reducing the other one.
That, but it means that it is not.
Yeah.
It's not. I didn't understand what somebody. I said, is it Pareto optimal? And people say, students say, like this. I say, why? And then okay. Everybody understands that it is not Pareto optimal. Why? Because you can increase both utilities without decreasing utility of other. So, is it Pareto optimal? Is it Pareto optimal? Yes, yes, yes. And of course, this also. So, what we have is that the best reply will be not Pareto optimal. And this is bad. Because without any cost, they could get better. Okay? So individual rational agent will defect. And this guarantee payoff, because it guarantee payoff better than with cooperation. Because with cooperation it will be 0, with defection it will be 2. And it will be best response to all possible strategy. But if they cooperate, they both get better. But because of, if you start, okay, let me cooperate, but you do not trust your partner, then it will be bad for you. Okay? Why we consider this prisoner's dilemma as a serious, but not, let us say, some toy example? Because actually, it's all about international negotiation. Arm rises, nuclear weapon complaint, it's also prisoner's dilemma. And what will be the best strategy according to this theoretical situation, to defend? Because if your partner decides to make disarming and you keep your weapon, it will be best utility for you. So this is why this is not a so-called very abstract situation. It's very particular and it can be applied in many real situations. However, it's not exactly what we have in real life. Because the game theoretical notion is wrong, and we not always maximize our own utility, but we also maximize social welfare. Which one of these outcomes will be social welfare maximizing solution? You remember what is social welfare? It is sum of maximal value for you, sum of utilities of all aging. Yes, actually this is what's called, and it says that even if we have individual different strategy, then we still behave in a way that we not only maximize our individual utility, but also maximize social welfare. Also, we may take a risk when risk is not too much and doesn't hurt us a lot. And finally, we can say that this dilemma is formulated wrongly according to our real life, but from the theoretical perspective, it's correct. How we can recover cooperation? And answer to this question is very simple. Try to do it several repeated negotiations. If it is only one time negotiation, that we can have a pure prisoner dilemma situation. But point is that even if you win in some negotiation with your partner on international treaties, that still you meet this partner next day again. And this is why your iteration may happen and prevent you from making some wrong solution. So basically, it means that if you make iterated prisoner's dilemma, then you can change your preferences and strategy. And in particular, you can initially start with cooperation, and then you can adopt to what your agent, what your partner does. Okay? But if it will be iterated, but with finite number, that on the last step, still best possible strategy will be defended. Also, there is another possibility, a so-called tit-for-tat strategy, when you start with cooperation and then you see what your partner does. You just repeat what your partner did on previous round. And according to that, you make decision. It's also possible strategy. And this is what how it may happen in real life. So if we have non-iterated prisoner's dilemma, then no chance to get cooperation. However, if we have iterated, and we have also maximizing the social welfare, then cooperation is possible. Is it clear? We start to consider possible strategies. What is strategy? Action that the main agent to do something. We start with one example where we consider different choices and how these choices can be done. How we can select choice. Of course, in a simple way, we just select what gives us best utility. But unfortunately, it depends not only on us, but it depends only on our partners. And we consider what would be our best utility in case when our partner did some action. And this is what is strategy. We select our next action based on maximizing our utility, but taking into account what our partner can do. Okay? Okay. Is it very simple and did I spend too much time on that? Or should I accelerate on? Okay? So, if we consider it pure theoretically, then there are different types of games. And particularly, there are also competitive and zero-sum interactions. In such kind of games, one agent can only get more preferred outcome at expense of other outcomes. For example, it is strictly competitive. So some outcome is better for one agent if and only if it is worse for other. Okay? another type of game that can also consider zero-sum encounter. When the sum of utility is zero, it means that utility can be positive and negative. Negative is also bad, of course, and positive is the highest. And this is example of game that we can see in our lives. They are checkers. So all type of board games and so on, there can be considered zero sum income. What is interesting, that in real life, people who make research in this area say that there are no zero sum for strictly competitive games. In all cases, there are some components that you cannot consider that killing of your enemy is the only best solution for you. Even with this arm race and nuclear weapon treaty, you consider that after your decision, our planet should still survive. And this is why it is not completely competitive and zero sum. But what is wrong that even if, it's important to know that there are no strictly competitive and zero sum games in our life. But in many negotiations, people behave like they are. They consider it's really zero sum. But no, there are in all negotiations that we consider, there is always some possibility to consider not strict competition. Okay. But next we will go to important result in negotiations here. We consider a problem of dominant strategy. And first of all, we start with the notion of dominance. Consider that there are any particular strategy, there will be a number of outcomes of this strategy. And we say that one strategy dominates another strategy if set of outcomes possible by playing one strategy preferred over a set of outcomes possible by playing another strategy. Very simple way. If we consider that this is outcomes and there are two strategies, A, or let us say S1, that has outcomes omega 1 and omega 2, and another strategy where we have outcomes omega 3 and omega 4. Which of these strategies dominate another?
That's wrong.
Of course. So it is clear what does dominate. If outcome of one strategy are better than outcomes of another strategy. This is a good situation that it is possible, but sometimes this overlaps. It's interesting that even in the prisoner's dilemma, there is no dominating strategy. It's the best strategy, but not dominating. It means not all outcomes of this strategy are better than outcomes of another strategy. You remember, cooperation can give better utility, but in some sense, more safe way of doing it. Follow the thing. Okay. And sometimes it's possible to design mechanism with dominant strategy. And then if we have such a possibility to dominate, then of course this is what agent should do. Agent is best of using a specific strategy, no matter what other strategy agent use. However, very often agent-based strategy depends on strategy of other agent, and that dominant strategy does not exist. In this case, there is another criteria that is used for selecting strategy that is called Nash equilibrium. Maybe you heard about this name, if maybe not, but doesn't matter. What is Nash equilibrium? Two strategies, S1 and S2, are in Nash equilibrium if, under assumption that agent one plays first strategy, agent J or second agent cannot do better than play second strategy, and vice versa. So it's situation in some sense like a Pareto optimality, but it is another kind of equilibrium. In this equilibrium, if you choose one strategy and the agent can do not, another agent cannot do better than play some other strategy and vice versa. This is equilibrium. It's not the best, but you cannot do in this situation better. Then of course, this is what you have to do. To find strategy that is best respond to other agent strategy. In this case, there will be only a very stupid agent who will deviate from this Nash equilibrium. So the notion of Nash equilibrium is good, that if you have Nash equilibrium in your protocol, that agent will be cannot do better than use strategy according to this Nash equation. Okay? Okay. So, this was for two agents, but Nash strategy is defined for n agents. For example, if we have strategy profile from S1 to Sn, from A for agent from 1 to n, and Si agent best strategy can be considered given that other agent choose strategy from the rest of this strategy profile. Actually, this formulation is just extension of what we consider for two agents. For L agent, it's all agent, there is set of strategy, and if one select one strategy, the other has no better choice, but select other strategy according to this criteria. In Nash equilibrium, each agent chooses a strategy that is best response to other agent strategy. And then question is, what we did in prisoner's dilemma? What kind of strategy we choose? It was not dominant strategy. But what was this? Was it Nash equilibrium? Yes. With assumption of the fact that your agent, your partner play defect, you have no better choice than play defect. Okay? So it means that Nash equilibrium is what you have to look for when you try to decide about what your strategy should be in negotiation. Okay? So, just to remind you, we consider a negotiation as having protocol and strategy. Protocol's property we already considered previously. Now we consider what kind of strategy to choose. We don't know exactly. In each particular negotiation, it will be its own. But there are common properties that you have to remember. And this common property, if there exists Nash equilibrium strategy, then take it. No better choice. Okay? The problem is that what we consider now is so-called pure Nash equilibrium, pure strategy. And for this case, how we can compute this Nash strategy, we just consider all possible responses, analyze them, and it's computationally hard, but it is possible. But it may happen that Nash equilibrium in this pure case doesn't exist. There are some games where without Nash equilibrium. It is so, this is an example of so-called matching penny game. You and your partner, you have some point, and you decide together at one moment, say head or tail. If two tails or two heads, then agent I win. If they are different, then agent J win. So what is here Nash equilibrium? Actually, it doesn't exist. Because whatever strategy you choose, you always can do it better. If you knew what was what is really your partner's reply. If you hear, then you can improve it, and hear this can improve it, and so on, so on. There are no clear cell in this pair of matrix that say, okay, this is our Nash equilibrium. Okay? And unfortunately, there are games where Nash equilibrium doesn't exist. But there is something good about this Nash equilibrium, that actually we can introduce something additional to overcome this situation. We can introduce randomness. For example, let us play a game rock, paper, scissors. Everybody knows?
Yeah.
Nobody there here who doesn't know how to. Yes. Paper, road, business. Yeah. So, if we can see the payoff matrix here, that we cannot see what is the best case, what is the strategy to do, what strategy to choose. However, let's introduce randomness, and this randomness will be called mixed strategy. We introduce that one strategy has probability, some probability, another strategy has some probability, and such strategy has some probability. So in this case, we can have three strategies to choose, to rock, paper, or scissors. And if they all have the same probability, then what is your strategy? Very simple. Choose randomly. No surprise, yes? Choose randomly. And this is Nash equilibrium. Because if you do this, there is no, under the assumption of equal probability, there is no better way of doing it. And theoretically it's clear, but you will be very surprised if you look into internet and find there is society and community of people discussing how to play better in this game. Why? Because actually in real life it maybe may happen that not all probability are equal. And you know that your partners prefer paper all the time, then you can create your strategy. But then you change probability. And based on this changing probability, you select your Nash equilibrium. What is good about this introducing of probability? And this is theorem that says every game where a player has a finite set of possible strategy has Nash equilibrium in mixed strategy. So if you have randomness, then it's proven that Nash equilibrium exists. As you understand, that the author of this theorem is Nash, and he got Nobel Prize for this theorem. So it means that for mixed strategy, where each strategy has some probability to be performed, then in this mixed strategy, there always exists a Nash equilibrium. And this is good for us to know. It's not so easy to know how to compute this, because computational complexity can be very hard. What is the Nash equilibrium? But theoretically, it exists. Okay? Is it clear what is Nash equilibrium? I believe that independently of age and software and so on, you will have use of this knowledge in the future. Knowing this, what is Pareto optimal and Nash equilibrium, will give you some good knowledge that you can use. Okay. Everything is good with Nash equilibrium? Not actually. Because it says only that Nash equilibrium exists, but maybe more than one Nash equilibrium. Consider the game so-called battle of sex. There is a man and woman. They like each other, and they would like to go, would like to spend some evening on some place outside of their home. And there are two possibilities: to go to a movie and see Mission Impossible 5. Sorry, it was very old slide, maybe now it's another movie, but similar type. Or go to ballet. You can consider that having disagreement is the lowest possible utility, because they would like to spend this evening together. However, if you consider going to cinema or to ballet, they can be also considered as the best strategy, but which one to choose is not clear. Okay? So just to show that the Nash equilibrium existence theorem is very strong and very nice result, but it's not that solve all your problems. You have to know what are limitations of this Nash equilibrium. Basically, basic problems with Nash equilibrium is that Nash equilibrium may not exist for some problems with are not mixed strategy, but for mixed strategy it exists. And multiple Nash equilibrium may exist, and it is not obvious which agent to apply. It guarantees stability only at the beginning of game, and Nash equilibrium is often too weak because people may create coalitions. It is not coalitions free in some sense that you cannot guarantee that your Nash equilibrium strategy selected is best if there are collision points. Okay. I think this is an extremely good point to make a break. But if you have some questions about Nash equilibrium, we can discuss. So once again, what did we consider? We tried to consider, you remember, we started with monotonic concession protocol in order to decide what would be a good strategy for this protocol. In order to understand this good strategy, we went to consideration of what are property of strategy. And considering this property of strategy led us to the notion of Nash equilibrium, that is good property that also could be a very good property of your negotiation protocol.